sweet, erecting like flame its eyes, with finger pointing to many immortal songs and menacing voice. What singest thou? It said. Knowest thou not there is but one theme forever enduring bards, and that is the theme of war? Be it so then, I answered. I, haughty shade, also sing of war, and a longer, greater one than any, for life and death, for the body and for eternal soul. Lo, I too am come chanting the chants of battle. I, above all, promote brave soldiers. This is the last in the series of wrestlings, being the last Sunday in August, and it's called Dragon Sleeper, which is also the name of a wrestling hold. Dragon Sleeper, dragon. That's a very good image. It comes from two Greek words, the first one meaning a huge serpent or snake, and the second one meaning one who sees clearly. I thought that the second one was interesting. In the Orient, the dragon is regarded as the master of all elements, and in European lore, the dragon is winged to fly above things, to get an overview, has a sense of the big picture. So this is Dragon Sleeper today. There is a dragon alive in our midst. It's interesting where biblical names come from, and of course the name of Moses is no different. Some find you are meeting God. And we do that. We do meet God, surprisingly, and we know it. That's how stories like this get written down and remembered. The holy mountain of God is not a moment to be feared or to be fled. It is a moment full of gifts and strange opportunities. Indeed, the poet Isaiah, in his 25th chapter, writes of it on this mountain. The Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wines, strained clear. God will destroy the shroud cast over all peoples, will swallow up death forever. God will wipe away the tears from all faces. That sounds like a wonderful place to be, suddenly to find yourself and the dragon awake on the mountain of God. What another thing we didn't see coming was the business of the burning bush. And that happens to us as well. Strange things, things that never happen and things that shouldn't happen, but suddenly they're happening. Fire burns bushes and they turn to ash, we say. And yet the fire is burning and the bush is green. Ever see moments like that? I've taken time over the month of August to spend time out here in the sanctuary while the church is open to the public. I put on my collar and I walk up and down the aisles and I meet people and I walk them around and I show them the sanctuary and I show them the organ and I show them the mice. And then I ask them why they came into the church and how glad they are to see them. One man said to me, "This is my annual visit to St. Michael's Hospital." I said, "Oh." "Yes," he said, "I had a kidney donated to me 8 years ago. On the 8th floor." I said, "Yes, I was on the 8th floor myself. I had some kidney work done as well." "Oh," he said, "then you know." "I go, yes." He said, "Well, every year on the anniversary of my surgery, I take flowers to the 8th floor, and I go to the bed in which I stay, and I give the flowers to who's ever there. And I say, this was a wonderful bed for me. I know it will be a wonderful bed for you." He said, "The most remarkable thing was, those 8 years ago, I suddenly realized that I was in serious trouble. I had kidney disease, and I needed a kidney transplant. And I was making up my will at the time, funny thing. And I was sitting with my lawyer, and I said, 'Oh, by the way, as you're making up your will, you have to realize that I'm going to have a kidney transplant.' And after a few moments, the lawyer said, 'What does that involve?' Well, I told him as best I could. I said, 'But the thing is, I have an unusual blood type. It's O negative.' The lawyer said, 'Gee, my blood is O negative as well.' And the conversation went on. And about 10 minutes later, the lawyer said, 'I'd like to give you one of my kidneys.'" Is that what your English moment? "It's been remarkable," he said. "I'm so overwhelmed and so grateful. Every year on the anniversary of the day, I take flowers and I say, 'It's going to be well for you as well.'" A burning bush moment. I said, "May I tell my people that story?" He said, "Absolutely. I'll even give you the name of a lawyer." Well, when you see a burning bush moment, you realize it by your own reaction to it. You realize you're in a very different world from the one you thought you were in. There is amazement first, and then curiosity about it, and then a sense of sudden smallness. Who am I in the face of such grace and truth, we say. And we take off our shoes because we know we are on holy ground. The dragon is awakening. The dragon awakens in the sudden anchoring in your life because suddenly you realize who God is. You realize you're not alone in this existence. You realize it isn't just about the headlines you read in the paper every day. You realize it isn't just life and death and a scruffy few years in between. You realize at some deep level there is another power with us, another power not hidden, but simply involved more deeply in life than we realize. And God says three things to Moses which are important for us to hear. God says, "I hear." Whatever is going on in the din of the world, never doubt for a moment that I hear every single word and every unspoken word about it. "And I care," says God. Not at a distance, not treating you as nothing, but treating you as everything. The children whom I have fashioned for and whom I love. And God says, "I act." It may take time, it may be slow in your minds, but there is a process unfolding by which the world shall be redeemed. Do not lose heart. The dragon is awakening. When the dragon awakens, you discern afresh who you are as well. You are from of old with expectations put upon you. struggle for truths just for themselves? Do you not think that back in their day they spent time looking around the years to the names and faces which have become us in our day and have passed on to us all the deep things of their life that we might carry them through our generation? We come from of old with expectations placed upon us. We also come from today with potential all around us. We have a spine with which to stand up straight, voices to speak, and insight to read through the guff and the crack, and we have the power to step forward and speak and make change. And we come from the future as well with a blessing. Centuries from now, our children's 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 children will look back on our life's moments and in a quiet word say thank you for things we dared to do in our brief years under the sun. One of the interesting things that happens when I meet people who come into the church for the first time is that they say, we're so surprised to see the priest. We go to churches all over the place, and we see the building and the organ and the stained glass, but we never see the priest. We got to see the priest. I said, yes, this is the priest we got to see. Well, I think generations in the past, down the years, will say the same thing of us. They're not only gifts coming to us, not only insights and visions and truths, but we've actually got to see the priests, the ones who carry them, and the priests we are. And the dragon awakens to tell us our true mission as well. And this is where it gets tougher and more demanding. We are to free the slaves, says the voice of God. Those who are blind and deaf and speechless and invisible among us. We know who they are up close, we see them on the streets, we read about them in the newspapers, see their faces on the news. We are to see how it is, we are to dare to feel something of the oppression that pushes down on human lives, we are to love the humanity which is lost simply by the vast collection of numbers, and we are to challenge the powers that hold our humanity down. Well, our reaction, not surprisingly, is the one that Moses had. Who am I to do this? Who am I to do this? And you can hear Moses walking quietly up to the dragon who's just coming away and singing, lullaby and good night, go to sleep, go to sleep. We don't want to face that responsibility. It's too big for us. What we, just little folk, we say, we've been pressed into thinking we're little folk in the generation in which we live. And then we hear the voice of God. I will. That's the greatest phrase you will ever hear in your life. The voice of God saying, I will be with you. You've seen it in moments of your own burning bushes. You've seen it in the clarity of the place on which you have stood, the mountain of God. You have sensed it in the nature of our mission as human beings, how sacred it is. And you have realized that there are ashes dropping from that bush, even as it refuses to burn, ashes of affection and kindness and generosity and courage, which we are to pick up, put into our pockets, and carry with us wherever we go. It won't be easy. Paul knew this as he wrote to the people of Rome. He never met them, you know. He was writing to encourage them in their Christian lives in the great city of the greatest empire in the world. He said to them, love with all sincerity, loathe evil, and cling to goodness. Love the tribe on whom you live with affection. Give private place to others. Oh, that is so difficult when we're all striving to get there ourselves. Honor the demands made on your life, and perhaps most importantly, let God settle your scores. You don't have to go around with your fist clenched all the time, waiting to get in that one punch that's going to get you even for things. Let God settle the scores, says Paul. And the gospel writer knew that love is constantly true. It involves a cross. Oh, there's a cross. Once you meeting unengaged souls, we awaken to them and find ourselves in a different world. There is a way for us to move from the valley of insignificance to a mountain profound with meaning, beautiful wines, sweet breads, and the end of death. You see, the end of all this is to bring people to the burning bush moment for themselves. You bring people as far as you can, opening to them the possibility of standing on God's holy mountain, and then by God's grace, they themselves see a bush which is aflame and still green with leaves. It's their own miracle, they realize it for themselves, they acknowledge it, and their lives begin to change. Each life is to have a shocking moment, a true knowing, after which the dragon begins to awake. About 3 years ago, on a holiday weekend in July the 1st, a little three-year-old boy drowned in the lake of Wales. I knew him well. Indeed, his mother and father were great friends of our family. I married him, I baptized the little guy. His name was Duncan Welsh, and he was the most remarkable little boy, curious. They let him out of the car along with all the other children, and within 1 minute, he slipped down the hill along. Later, they found him under the boat in 10 feet of water. They worked so hard to bring him back to life. 25 minutes on the dock, air ambulance from Toronto, brought him to St. Children's Hospital. I remember going in with his father and watching that team of doctors and critical care people working on a child I'd never seen him work so hard. And they put him on life support system as his brain had ceased to function. And that hospital and all their friends gathered around him as they had 2 full days to lie in bed with that little boy, telling how much they loved him, and then his organs were donated to 3 other children who are alive and well today. And Duncan's funeral was here at Metropolitan Church on a warm day. His mother, Victoria, was remembering that, and she wrote a piece for it that I asked if I could read to you today. The church doors stood closed for me. In a few minutes, they could swing open, revealing a crowd of mourners gathered to pay tribute to my perfect, happy, mischievous, three-year-old boy. I wasn't ready to say goodbye, to face the mournful, pitiful looks that awaited me. I wasn't ready to hear loving tributes about a life snuffed out too short. I wasn't ready to accept that I could see Duncan grow up, never to know what he could have become, never to see his infectious smile again, never to feel his warm hand in mine. Between me and the door was the pale wooden coffin, chosen back on the numbness of still protecting my heart from this horrific reality. Back when I could sit in the funeral home and make decisions, plan arrangements, assign speakers, choose music. That numbness allowed me to organize and welcome the arrival of family and friends who traveled great distances to be present. Numbness was quickly dissipated. I stared down those church doors hard, tears on my face, willing them to remain closed. As the piper began to tune, a blue ball of dandelion floated across the coffin and came to stop at my eye level. The sun flickered through it, giving it an eerie, angelic glow. It hovered there as if the skirl of the pipes were keeping it suspended. I was mesmerized. As the piper struck up Highland Cathedral, the blue ball began to sway to and fro, doing a quiet little dance for me. It brought a curious smile to my face. For a moment, I forgot my surroundings. I was made calm by its simple, bright beauty. Warm peace washed over me as if time had stopped.